next talk is Deploying Scalable Django Application on AWS by Mr. Lalit Nama.
Lalit is passionate about technology. Currently, he works as a system analyst with Rhinoceros Technologies in Singapore. He believes in benefits of getting exposure to multiple technologies, and thus he had the chance to work with PHP, Mercator, Java, Android, Python, and a few more. Having implemented and deployed several enterprise applications on AWS, Azure, and Google App Engine, he carries strong hands-on experience on deployment in the cloud. He believes Python is a great platform for developing enterprise applications, and deploying it on AWS adds performance and scalability. So let's welcome Mr. Lalit Nama.
Thank you. Hello all. So my talk will be around making your application AWS ready, how you can plan the scalability and fault tolerance and make your application disaster recovery. And the talk will be having to deploy application on AWS. So it will not just applicable on Django. You can map it to any general purpose web application. So you can map it to other languages also, like PHP, Java, and other. So let's start. I think you already heard about AWS, because when you talk about cloud, the first name comes is AWS, Amazon Web Services. And so I will give a brief introduction of that. And then the next will be the services you need to know, because AWS provides a lot number of services for different purposes, but the services you need may be different. So what are the basic services you need to know to make your application deploy on AWS? Second, we will see the AWS scalable architecture. I will go through some steps so it can help you to think how we can move to the scalability, because this is a topic which can go a long way. So step by step, we will see how we can add scalability, we can think to make our application. And next, we will see about Django specific, because we will have to use the S3 service. So let's see how to integrate. And then the deployment methods. There are a couple of deployment methods I will talk. So let's see, starting from AWS services. You can see here is the console of AWS services, and you can see AWS provide a number of different services in different categories, like compute, it provide EC2 for database, it provide RDS. For database, it provide RDS and networking also, deployment services, mobile specific services. There are lot number of services, 45 plus services already launched, and every year they launch at least 2-3 services. But you don't need to know all those, just the basic one, and then as per your application requirement, you can learn more and implement more. Like Hari Krishna explained about some services, and so there are a number of services. Let's see the basic services you need to know. The basic one is EC2. EC2, you can see, is a virtual machine in cloud where you can host your operating system, you can install your application. So this is the basic service you must need to use to host your application on AWS. Second is RDS. RDS, okay, firstly, AWS is infrastructure as a service. It means everything you have to manage yourself. They do not provide platform as a service, but do not provide managed service. But some services of AWS is managed, like RDS is one of them, where it provides a managed RDS service where you can host your database. They provide around 4 or 5 database support, like MySQL, MS SQL, Oracle. So you can just start RDS instance, deploy your database, and do not worry about database backup, automatic patches installation. It does itself. So this is the managed service on top of AWS IIS infrastructure. And next service, if you talk from storage, you take S3. S3 is a popular service for storage of user content, static content of your site, like JavaScript, CSS, images, etc. One service also, Route 53. Route 53 is a scalable domain name service. So it's very easy to use service. You just point your domain controller name server to the Route 53 name server, and you can map your domain to any particular EC2 or load balancer URL, so your users can access the AWS services. CloudFront is on top of S3. It is a content delivery network which you can use if you want that your content should be really fast to download on user side, if you are hosting like media, images, video. So using the CloudFront network, it will be delivered using the nearest location of user physical location. The next service you can you might be interested in is CloudWatch. CloudWatch is a monitoring service which monitors the AWS resources. Mostly we monitor using EC2 and RDS, where you can monitor some parameters like CPU utilization, disk reads, writes, and network traffic. And depending upon that, you can take some business decision, like if you are running out of resources, you can increase the resources, or you can set some rules. So depending upon the states, like if CPU utilization is more than 80% for 5 or 10 minutes, it can automatically start new instances to add the scalability and will never let your application down. So you can do some sort of stuff. And we can talk one deployment service. One deployment service, Elastic Beanstalk. It's a deployment service. So as I already said, it's an infrastructure service, but on that it provides a platform as a service. The one service is deployment service, Elastic Beanstalk, where you can set up your application and it will automatically start for EC2, RDS, create buckets for you. So resource provisioning, you can just set up and it will automatically do yourself. You do not need to start EC2 separately or RDS, S3 and CloudWatch and different. It provides combination of those services in a single single console. So it's one of important deployment service. I will talk later on that. My point, the scalable, how to think scalability when you are moving to cloud. So we will see some steps how you can think. So let's start from single box model. Single box means EC2. EC2 is your server operating system, like Linux or Windows. Everything is in single box. Your operating system is there, your server is there, like Apache is there, your database like MySQL is there, your user content, your user images, videos, everything is in single box. So you can go with like shared hosting or some dedicated server is like this, the single box model, everything is inside. This is a representation of AWS architecture where you can see I mentioned the region and availability zone. So currently AWS have 9 or 10 regions. Singapore is one of them. So there is a data centers, and inside one there is 2 physical availability zones. So 2 or more physical availability zones. Singapore we have 2. So inside one availability zone, I am running a single EC2 instance. The user is directly hitting our server. So this can also work, but this is not scalable because everything in single box. If it fails, everything fails. So let's use AWS services, AWS different services which AWS provide and make it scalable. So first service comes in mind is RDS, database. You take out your database MySQL out and host it in RDS. That's a managed service. So you don't need to worry about backups and different thing. And if your EC2 is down, your RDS is still safe. So your database is still safe. So this is one point you can implement scalability. Next, add more services like S3 bucket. You can take out your user content to S3 bucket. So everything after deployment of application, whatever user is uploading, will go into S3 bucket. Now your EC2 is only a pure application. The database is out, the user content is out. And the load on server will also be less because S3 can directly serve the user content to browser. So the EC2 will not busy in serving just a static content. A static content will be served from S3 directly to the user browser, and your EC2 will directly hit only for application usage. If you want more services or you want to make it more scalable, you can use Elastic Load Balancer there, where you can start at least one EC2 instance, means your one application server, and depending upon load, you can add more EC2 instances to handle the more load. Elastic Load Balancer also provide like auto scaling group. You can create some policies depending upon your application nature. Like you can say that if CPU utilization is more than 70% for 10 or 15 minutes, start another instance. Like that, you can set the rules. It's very easy to set tools in AWS console. AWS console, where you see the services, where you can manage these rules. So it can automatically start instance when the traffic will increase. And you can set the load also. The rules like if CPU utilization is less than 30% for more than 10%, down the one instance, it will save you cost actually. So return on investment, you can justify your client that, yeah, it will, like in the daytime or in the evening time, if your traffic is up, and the night time it's not up, So you can manage these kind of things. Even you can manage, like you have in the weekend your application get traffic more, so you can set the rule only on the weekend it start one instance and add to the load balancer. So a lot of stuff you can do to make your application scalable. See more if you want to make purely disaster DR system, where you can set up in one availability zone one instance, and the second availability zone you set up another instance, one instance initially, and later depending upon load it can start one more instance in one availability zone or another, or in the both. And this is on the EC2 application layer. And also in the database layer you can make a scalability, like you can have master or slave concept. You can deploy multi availability zone deployment. We have a service, means when you start RDS there is option to multi-agent, means it will have a copy in the second availability zone within the same region, and it will be directly syncing. You cannot directly use the slave database, but when master database will fail, it will automatically transfer your load to the secondary database. So you do not need to worry if something happen on the hardware failover on the AWS side, still you are safe. Even one availability zone will be completely down, like there is a mass failure of hardware in AWS side, one agent is down, but second agent is still there, and automatically load will be transferred to there. So because there also we will be having at least one EC2 and the slave database, so transfer will be there. And S3 is outside of that, so even your OS goes down, no need to worry, because it's only application, pure application, and we have multiple instances of that application. So your system will be scalable and also DR. If you want to want more scalability or more things, you can use other services, like for domain name you can use Route 53. So your domain controller will be here, DNS controller, and then you can map that to your Elastic Load Balancer URL. So your user will hit the domain, and then using the Route 53 it will go to the load balancer, and the load balancer will see which server is less traffic, and then you route the request to the particular instance, and instance will reply to load balancer and load balancer to your browser directly. Same for S3 bucket, you can see you can use the CloudFront CDN service. So if you really want to ensure the static content is really being downloaded fast on user browser, you can use the CloudFront. On top of these, other you can use the CloudWatch monitoring service to monitor your EC2 instances. Your network administrator may really need it. It can immediately send you SMS or email alerts when something is going wrong on your EC2 instance or RDS instance. You can use IAM, Identity and Access Management service. If you are working in a big team, you want to give access only to S3 service or only to EC2 service to some user, you can manage in the IAM role easily. You create a role, just give the permission of only particular service, and he will be able to use only that service. You can use SES, simple email service. It's like SMTP. It provides SMTP, you just utilize it and start sending emails. And so these are basic services which you can utilize, but definitely there are a lot more, like Lambda for mobile. There is also mobile testing and deployment service. So this is one way of thinking. This is just a start. You can add more services as per, like you can use SQSL service, and like you can use if you want to make PDF to Word conversion service, like so user just upload PDF and you have to convert it into Word, like that you can do. But here you can use SQS service, so user will upload the PDF first, and then you can send it to the SQS, and SQS will use the one server to convert it, and after convert it will automatically send an email that you can download, your conversion is done. So this type of service you can use the small instance. So if traffic increase, even it can utilize the small size instance and utilize it, it will be cost effective to you. Instead of saying that you are running a one instance of 2 GB RAM and the traffic immediately increase, and then your server cannot handle that. So you can use queue service also. So there are a lot number of services you can utilize. And now see, specific to Django. I already explained that you have to use S3, RDS at least. So how to integrate S3 in Django? So Django is very easy, S3, because AWS provide AWS SDK for different languages, for PHP, Python, Java, .NET, everything it provides. For Python, it provides Boto. Current version is 3, so Boto 3 library that provide AWS SDK. You can utilize that. You can store any file you can store to S3. You can refer from S3. You can create buckets, delete objects. So everything it provides in the wrapper, it's AWS SDK. And what you can use for S3, I already explained that you can use for static files like your JavaScript, CSS, images. One thing, it's part of application. Second, user content. If user is imaging, uploading its profile, photo, videos, images, etc., or documents. So everything you can store in the S3. And how to set up for S3? So for S3, you can use one application, Django Storages. Django Storages is the Django application which enable you to utilize another storage. Like your application is hosted on one server, generally it save into the a single folder of that. But if you want to utilize Amazon S3, Azure Blob Storage, or Cloud Storage of Google, Django Storage provide a number of storages into your Django. It coupled, so your code will not change, but when your user will upload something, you write the code, and user will upload image, it will, instead of saving on the server, it will save into the storage, which is linked. Like if you are using S3, it will save S3. It will, if you are using Azure Blob Storage, it will save there. So you use Django Storages. It's very easy to install. Pip install Django Storages. And also the same way you can install Boto 3. And in the setting, it's very easy. You go into setting.py, you add your storages application and a couple of settings. For S3, we generally use access key, secret key, and then bucket name is there. You have to mention the bucket name, and you have to mention static files storage and default file storage. So it will change the storage. Default file storage, if you change to the Boto 3 storage, S3 storage, then everything what you are going to upload, it will upload to the S3 bucket. So using this storage application, it's nothing to change in the application. I'm dividing in two parts. First thing is static files of your application, how to upload there, and then user content. First, if you do for S3, you use for static files, what you can do is you can directly copy and paste your S3, your files like JavaScript, CSS to the S3 bucket, and then automatically it will start using when on the front end, on the Django, when you want to reference any image, it will directly refer from bucket. You just need to mention that static. When you are IMG SRD, when you are mentioning, you have to write static keyword first, and then according to the storage class you are using, it will take reference and will add after that. So in the S3 bucket, it will add the S3 bucket path, its HTTP path, and then images or your image name. So front end is very easy. In the back end, I say you can manually copy paste. But if you do not want that, you can use another application, static files app. So you install your static file apps, and you just run a command on your application, python manage.py collect statistics. So what it will do, it will collect all the static files like JS, CSS of your project, and will upload those to the S3 bucket, which you mentioned in the last slide. I showed you static files storage is the bucket already there, and bucket name I already mentioned. So static file will utilize this setting, and it will know that we have to use S3, and it will copy your static content directly to the S3 bucket. So you do not need to copy manually to S3 for your static contents. So it's very easy to use, and for reference, I say it's also very easy. You just add static, and according to the storage class you are using, it will already refer there. And if you want to store user content, you do not need to change anything. This is the sample code which you generally use. First function is upload avatar to. It's just renaming the file which you are going to upload, and your upload is simple, like you are having the model image field. So when you are going to upload image, it will upload with a new name, and where it will upload, because you already set it, the default storage class is S3, so it will automatically go into the bucket you mentioned and will save there. And we want to refer it the same like IMG SRC, you just use the URL of your model, like profile.avatar.url, and it will automatically show the correct URL, because in the backend setting you changed the storage of your Django where it is going to store. So it's nothing changed. It's the general way you are using your code to upload. So S3 we already integrated, and RDS is there is no change. RDS means database. You just start your database and change the credential and start using that. So we have already used EC2 where we are our Django application is hosted, RDS where our database is hosted, and S3 where our CSS images or user content is being stored. Now this is the custom deployment. So this is the first thing. The deployment way is custom deployment, where you have to start your EC2 manually, deploy your application, and S3 integration you have to do, and manually you start RDS, manually you create a bucket and do this setting stuff, and just it's ready to use. You just point your domain to your EC2 instance directly, or whether you use load balancer. So this is the custom deployment. After every deployment, like I say, you EC2 is volatile. If you will terminate the instance, everything will stop, everything will lost. So you have to save it. So in Amazon, there is a concept AMI, Amazon Machine Image. So it's very easy to create the image. You just right click of running EC2 instance or create image. It will copy a snapshot of your operating system within the data inside. So the application will be inside. Okay. So every time you change into your application, you have to create a AMI, and then you have to give that AMI to your load balancer. So whenever there is a trigger event of creating a new instance, it will use that base AMI. Base AMI will already contain your operating system and your Apache and your application code. So it can work. So this is one way of doing the deployment. The another way of doing deployment is Elastic Beanstalk. In Elastic Beanstalk, what you are going to do, your application code is not inside the EC2. It's outside. It means you just create an environment first and then upload your application code separately. And when you upload your application code, it do not go into EC2 directly. It firstly goes to the S3 bucket. It automatically create a bucket in your account, and your application will store into S3. So whenever a new instance want to start, when your auto scaling policy want to start a new instance, it have the base AMI. It have the softwares already, like packages already, which you need, but do not have the application. After starting the EC2 instance, it download your application code from S3 bucket and extract there. So now it's more scalable, and you do not need to create AMI again and again after every deployment of your code. So it's very easy to use deployment service of AWS, and you can utilize it using console also. You go into console, you start your environment. Firstly, you have to create an environment there, and then you have to upload your application there, and it will just directly run. It automatically create load balancer. It always comes with the load balancer. So you have to point your domain to the load balancer URL, and yeah, it started working already. Or if you are using command prompt, you can use EBCLI. It's command line interface that AWS provide. Using some commands, you can deploy your application. I will show some commands how to deploy your application on using Elastic Beanstalk. So firstly, we can configure the Elastic Beanstalk. In that, firstly, I'm activating the virtual environment on local. It's not doing anything on live on AWS first. So EB, VIRT, bin activate, you just activate it. And then according to your application requirement, you have to gather your requirement, like some additional packages you want to install. You just run pip fridge requirement.txt, it will generate. And this requirement.txt will have the dependency of your application, what additional packages you want to install. And this requirement.txt, your Elastic Beanstalk can understand. So whenever it will start server, it will download those dependencies automatically for you. And you have to create in your project folder, you have to create a .eb extension folder firstly. So let's create mkdir and create the folder. And after that, you have to create a django.config file. This file eb Elastic Beanstalk will read, and so you can see the code what is written. You have to write option settings AWS Elastic Beanstalk container Python and WSGI path. So container Python means it will start the Python container, because Beanstalk is a common service. You can start Python container, PHP container, or you can also have their option of selecting the Tomcat versions. So depending upon your container, it will start the AMI and will install the server, default server there. So you are asking about Python container, and you are mentioning the WSDA path it will use of your application. So then the application can run, and you are just deactivating this virtual environment. This is the optional step. So firstly, now you make your application ready to deploy an Elastic Beanstalk, but it's only on local, your computer, just not going to the EB service now. So how to deploy? You just initialize it, EBINIT. This is the command. You run it, and then Python version and Django test, your application name, your project name. So it will create the application, and then you have to again run the same command, EBINIT. At that time, it will ask you the couple of questions about the creating a key pair file, the name and the hash, and that will help to log in into the EC2 instance, because EC2, it's the operating system. To access that, you need a private key file, PPK file. So this is the steps that generate. I am not going into detail of that, but if you will execute this, you can see what it is asking, and you can enter the details. And then you create EB create Django environment. As I say, Elastic Beanstalk work in environment. So you can create one production environment, one staging environment. So you just create one environment, and there it just start a operating system. We said like Python container, so it will start a Python container, and that's it. No application deployed yet. So the environment takes around 5 minutes, and after that environment will be up. You can and it will automatically deploy your application. As soon the environment will be ready, it will install your application also, and it will be start running. And you can, in the browser, you can open the Elastic Beanstalk URL, and you can see your application. Or on the command line, you can type eb open. It will directly open the browser, default browser of your operating system, and will go you to the Elastic Beanstalk URL, and you can see your application already running there. So this is the way how you can utilize the console or the command line. And I already say console is very easy. You go into the console, you upload your application zip, you create your environment with selecting the Python container, it's in GUI, and just upload your application and you start using that. And the end result will be the same. It will start the load balancer with your application. And later you can setting it. Command line, it's very hard to do the configuration. Which images to use, or which what instance type you have to use. So you go to console and you can do your stuff there. You can set your auto scaling policies, your security groups, like you want to enable some port or disable some port, you can do that kind of stuff directly. And this is the command to redeploy. Whenever you do changes in your code, you want to redeploy, you just EB deploy. It will redeploy your application on the environment, and your application will be get update. So you see, we already seen two type of deployment, custom and this Elastic Beanstalk. And in this, your code will already having the correct RDS credential. You should you have to ensure that, so it can connect to correct RDS, and bucket you already integrated, and now it's scalable. So according to your policy, it can start new instances, or can down new instances. And so even the traffic goes increase, it will never let your site down, and it will be serving. So that's all. Thank you. Any questions? I think you must have. Okay, thank you.